great article yesterday. Netanyahu, we don't want messianic cult controlling nukes.
Bingo.
Tell us about this, because people need to realize there really is not two truths. As it says, you know, Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. And we have to follow in his way, which means we have to walk in truth. And that means spirit truth, economic truth, wellness truth, and geopolitical truth. And what we have right now is Mr. Iran. That's the actual words that they refer to him in Israel, because he's so focused on attacking Iran.
Yeah.
And we know that an attack on Iran is, right out of the Ezekiel 38 and 39, this is Armageddon. There's not going to be another war after this. As Einstein said, whatever, we don't know what they'll use in the Fourth World War, but it's probably sticks and stones, because the Third World War is going to be nukes. And Mr. Iran here wants to pull the trigger.
Well, Netanyahu's a hawk. We all know that. And people are divided on his opinion or on what he's going to do. The bottom line is this. We are in an impasse in the sense that if Iran gets the bomb, with the vitriol that we see from Ahmadinejad, the president of Iran, which has been going on for literally, you know, years now, and I'll just quote a few. Israel is a dry, withered tree, soon to be plucked up and thrown into the sea. Israel is a cancer, soon to be irradiated, and on and on and on it goes. There's actually a site that keeps track of his vitriolic vituperative exchanges towards Israel. That being said, and that established, they're also of the Shia sect of Islam. And there's a huge schism between Sunnis and Shia. So not only is Israel a little worried, well probably more than a little worried,
but
certain Sunnis are also alarmed at this, specifically Saudi Arabia, wondering whether Iran will attempt to set up some sort of an Islamic caliphate in the area. So it's a very complex political situation. Added to that is the religious fervor of Mr. Ahmadinejad. Because he's a Shia, he believes in their eschatological viewpoint or their end times viewpoint, meaning that they have to somehow usher in the Imam Mahdi, that they're waiting to have him manifest. And he can only manifest in a time of great chaos. I have it on record in Politics, Prophecy, and the Supernatural that he is willing, Ahmadinejad is willing to sacrifice up to a third of his country's own populace in order to bring about enough chaos to have the Imam Mahdi manifest. All that being said, Netanyahu's no dummy. He knows that if Iran gets the bomb, and he's gone on record saying it's Germany, it's 1939, and Ahmadinejad is Hitler. They already have, the Russians have already supplied the Iranians with the weaponry needed to get a nuke, let's say, to Tel Aviv. If we're into this sort of a scenario, it's a question of who is going to pull the trigger first. And, of course, if Israel pulls the trigger against Iran, that could touch off, you know, a huge regional war in the area. If the Iranians go for it first and attack Israel, then are we looking at the Ezekiel 38-39 scenario? And, of course, there's really no way to know exactly what is going to happen. What I am alarmed about is that this thing has been building now for several years with, Iran's nuclear ambitions. And, of course, the UN does absolutely nothing, which is why it's such an enervated, straw man. It's just absolutely nothing.
Well, it feeds off the chaos.
Anything. In the meantime, we are so close to having some sort of a conflagration over there, and hopefully cool heads will prevail. But I'm
not
confident
about that. Here's the prophetic word. And by the way, I'm going to make an announcement here. On Clay and Iron, which is my other website, I will be making the first three chapters of the scroll available on the front page so people can upload it free. Also, the Prayer of the 12 Stones, I'll post that up there so people will see it by this weekend. And I'm going to be putting up not only original articles I'm going to be writing, but I'm also going to be putting up what I call prophetic warnings, i.e., thus saith the Lord, referenced back to specific scriptures so people can see. We're there. We're not at a time when we're heading toward immediate war. We're going to have a certain amount of pain, death, and destruction before they whip the earth, literally like they've done already with the economic demolition they're doing on the 7th-plus anniversary of 9/11. They're getting ready to have the Oslo Accord culminated, and they're going to give billions in cash to Mr. Netanyahu and Lieberman. I believe it will be a quote, as it says in the book of Isaiah, a covenant with death for the state of Israel and the peoples of earth when they signed this covenant. This is to set up a parliament of religions, as the king of Saudi Arabia stated on the Temple Mount. It is getting ready to finally do this. So your comments, tell us about it.
Well, I mean, obviously, if whoever creates that treaty with Israel, whoever actually presents that as treaty with Israel, is none other than the Antichrist. I don't care who it is. Whoever creates that treaty and allows Israel to rebuild that temple on that Temple Mount is the Antichrist. And are we in that? I have a slightly different scenario. I believe that the next big thing on the stage is the Ezekiel 38-39 war, and I don't believe that that's Armageddon. Because there's a difference. Armageddon is all the nations coming into this area, well, and Ezekiel 38-39 is only a very select few.
Let me clarify
and you'll notice
that.
There's not an Arab amongst them, so it's not like the Palestinians joined the fray or Jordanians joined the fray.
Let me clarify
Russia,
that.
Iran, and a host of other countries. There's not an Arab in the bunch, which is really, really interesting.
Okay.
It's a totally different dynamic than what we're looking at now. But combined with that, of course, is the Isaiah 17 prophecy, which talks about Damascus being destroyed. There are many people that believe, and I am one of them, that Saddam did have chemical weapons. How do we know this? Because we have it on video. And you can just Google this on YouTube and see it. When he gassed the Kurds, he used sarin gas on the Kurds and wiped out, 100,000, 200,000 people. I mean, it was an absolute barbaric act. He had chemical weapons. The question is, he had weapons of mass destruction. He knew he was going to be invaded, more than likely, which is what has been done before, with this type of mindset. These weapons were probably shipped to Syria and are now laying, what I believe, in the Baqa Valley.
Yeah.
Interestingly enough, Israel said something about a year ago to Syria, not from one of their generals or cabinet members, I forget who it was, but they basically said this to Syria: if you use chemical weapons against us, we will annihilate you.
Right.
Now, just read between the lines and, connect the dots there. I think that Syria has access to those WMDs that Saddam shipped to them. And, we could be looking at...
Let me give you some more...
over there, Dr. D, it is unflippin' believable. It's through the roof.
Let me give you some additional information.
They're not going to sit down and have a nice little chat.
Exactly.
By the way, did you see Obama bowing to the Saudi Arabian king today?
Oh, no, I didn't. I didn't have a chance.
Unbelievable.
The
king is standing upright, and Obama bows to him, like, almost down to his waist. I mean,
that's ridiculous.
What the heck is that?
Exactly.
What the heck is that?
Okay, when we come back...
country, I mean, if he was in Japan, that's a whole different deal.
Absolutely. When we come back, I'm going to give some other connecting the dots pieces to this puzzle, and we can see there's not going to be one or two, or you're not going to be two or three wars. There's going to be a stuttering, coming to the precipice of disaster, and there's only one great war coming, not three. We'll be back in a moment.